Welcome to SIBKL's Sermon Podcast. We hope this message inspires you to go to grow disciples across the generations. If you'd like to connect with us, visit sibkl.org.my.
Okay, I'm going to introduce a speaker to you today, and he's really a treasure that we have him back with us even this holiday season. Incidentally, he's speaking as well at our prayer meeting this coming Tuesday at a prayer altar on Tuesday, where he will share a little bit more detail, things maybe he cannot share with us so publicly of what he's doing. He's Philip Poe, and he's here with his dear wife, Becky, and his five children. And now, I've memorized the names by heart, see whether I can remember it. The five children is, I forgot. Oh, no, falling away. I really forgot. Isabella, Joshua, Jedediah, Jesse, Peter, and Issachariah. Amen? All right. Whoa, whoa! And they're going to come up to the stage later on to sing and present an item before Philip shares. Now, who is Philip? Philip really is one of our own, and he was the original rout in Drunk Before Dawn. He was the original route in our season one of Drunk Before Dawn way back in 2004, you know. And that was the first major musical we've ever done, well, it's 12 years ago now. And he was the one that sang, and it was amazing, and we had a wonderful time, and many people were saved. And after that, he went over, the Lord called him as a missionary to Northern Tibet. Northern Tibet, where he has spent the last 11 years as a missionary in Northern Tibet. And the Lord has really, during his time there, of course, he met up with Becky, who comes from an illustrious missionary family. And Becky speaks Immaculate Mandarin. And you know afterwards when she speaks and greets you, I don't know what she'll say. You know, and it's amazing how God has led this man, taken this man to witness for him in one of the most remotest parts and difficult parts in the world, in Tibet. But he is not a nobody. Amazing, what encourages me is that here is a brain. Here is someone who could have made it in life. You know, he did his bachelor's in mathematics and got his master's in Harvard, you know. A master's in Harvard. He was in political science. And he was really, really going for broke. He told me that if I had not become a missionary, I would have become a very successful politician in Sarawak, because he hails from Sarawak. And of course, and then he told me that I will probably land up in jail by now because I would have received a lot of donations. And God used him, and now in all the work that he's done in Tibet, there's so much things I can talk about him. You know, he's doing a PhD at the moment from Oxford online, and he's got to go there to do a PhD. And the PhD thesis will really amaze you. He has come out with a mathematical formula, of course it's a mathematics major, on how to predict with some degree of accuracy when you do a certain assessment with a mathematical formula whether as a leader you will fall or not. How to do it? Huh? PhD, man, you see? It's from Oxford. So he's finished his PhD already. He told me it's about 83,000 pages, right? 83,000 words thesis. No, 83,000. You were spending your entire life writing a thesis, 83,000 words thesis, and he's finished it already. And I said, once that is passed, you know, can you test me? You know what I mean? Right, I'm going to now hand over the time even to Philip Poe. Okay, put your hand together and welcome back to his home church, SIBKL, Philip Poe and Becky. And afterwards, he's going to introduce his come on, church, you can do better than that. Come on, why don't we all stand? Why don't we all stand? Come on, let's all stand. And welcome back our own son of the house. Amen.
God bless you. Thank you so much.
Thank you. Whoa.
Thank you. Can you hear me? All right. This is doing well. Thank you, Pastor Chiu, for a wonderful introduction. I remember, and as I was sitting here just now, singing, and I look back, I remember 13, 14 years ago, I was sitting somewhere there. And of course, it's not here. It was in CP Tower then. And I was then a very immature and irreverent and impertinent young man, you know, who thought that he could change his world in 7 days. And in my youthful days, I thought it unnecessary to attend church. But during one of the few days when I did, I remember hearing a sermon from Pastor Chiu about flying high and lasting long. And that's many years ago. You can do your math, okay? And later I'll be sharing about flying high, lasting long, and living on. And I just want to tell you this. What the seed that the pastoral team have sown, many have sprouted and many have grown. So I just, please give a big hand to all the pastoral team. And as Pastor Chiu has introduced, I have 5 kids for now. This is what happened. I was telling people, what do you call people who use Chinese contraception? We call them parents. So before I start my message, I'd like to invite all my kids, well, 4 of the older ones, to come up. They are going to sing a song. Now, how many of you know how many are there? How many judges are there in the book of Judges? Do you know all their names? All right, join the club. Okay, let the young people these days educate you. They're going to sing a song, a cappella, and it's going to be on the book of Judges. So pay attention because you're going to learn the names of all the judges.
Hello.
Okay, come forward. Hello. Here. Come forward here. Isabella, song leader, come here. All right, stand here. You want to switch? No, it's okay. All right, stand here. Stand in one line, please. All right, song leader, take it away.
You can turn on the TV today without seeing the cut room so. But the celebrity judges, they're driving the way, deciding to take home the dough. But long before television, yeah, people used to live without it. God sent celebrity judges to Israel. Here's a book about it. It's called Judges. That's the name. The subject and the title, I want the same. Like a book about Heather Conweather. Or a book about Heather Conheather. Who's Heather?
Oh,
No. All right, calm down, please. Calm down. As you can see, some of my children are quite a ham, and I don't know where they got it from. All right, what you see here is Tibetan costume. It's called wola. Usually, Tibetans will put precious things inside. So I'm going to reach inside and take out. Don't worry, this is not donation. This is what I'm going to speak today. All right. You guys have so much better paper than where I am. It actually crumbled. All right, let's pray. Abba Father, we want to thank you, Lord. It's so good to be back home. Lord, to be back at the house of the Lord. Lord, all these years, even when we were away, our hearts have never been too far, Lord, from this house of the Lord. Lord, we just want to thank you, Lord. Lord, as I speak, we ask that you will speak through this unworthy servant and vessel, Lord, that through this short time, Lord, I will be able to share with my brothers and sisters here, Lord, what you are doing, Lord, what your heart is today. In the name of Jesus Christ, I pray. Amen. Okay, 1 Corinthians chapter 9, verse 24 to 27. If you have a Bible, please flip to that. Okay, yeah, it's on the screen. Okay, you know this verses very well. Okay, it's Paul talking to the Corinthian church. Okay, so basically he used two analogies. He says, do you not know that in a race that all runners run, but only one gets a prize? So run in such a way that you get a prize. Okay, so everyone competes in a game, does what? Goes into strict training. No one comes to Olympic or to the arena unprepared. They do so to get a crown, and a crown that will not last. But what do? We do what we do so that when the time comes, we will get a crown that will last. Not one day, not one year, not 100 years, but last forever. Forever. So he says, therefore, I don't run like anybody who runs aimlessly, and I don't box like anyone who beat the air. I train my body. I train my body so that when the time comes, I will get a prize that will not rot and moth cannot eat and cannot destroy. Now, there were two things. One is running, one is boxing. And Paul uses both to Corinthian because back in those days, Corinth was known. Okay, it has a big arena. So when he used these two analogies, it was known to his audience what he was talking about. Today, I want to talk about fly high, last long, and after that, live on, live beyond. Okay, now we arrived early morning yesterday after some delay, and immediately, you know, we were so much loved. You know, by SIBKL, brothers and sisters just dropped by and giving us food, taking us out for dinner and lunch, and the meal between dinner and lunch. And after dinner, I mean, I don't even know how many meals. I told Becky that I have budgeted 5 kg for this whole 2 weeks that I'm here. I think the first day I blew 3 kg. I have put in application to extend my budget to 10 kg. All right, so Brother Yunlai, he was driving around yesterday, and then he was very proud as a PJ person. He was telling me, he says, do you know that where I live, and he lived near KDU, and he says, you know, many people like me, where I live, I don't have to go beyond my place. It's literally from cradle to grave. I could be born there. I could go to primary school, secondary school, college. I could get my job. I could give birth, and I could be cremated in that place. And in many ways, when I heard, it was quite amazing. This is such a blessing. Many people don't get that. And I was thinking, from crater to grave. Why? People seem to be obsessed with grave. In fact, Tibetans, they are obsessed all their life with what's going to happen to them when this life ends. Okay, if you know about Tibetan, they have a few ways of taking care of their body when they die. And it's a bit not like ours. We have cremation, and then we have burial. For Tibetan, unless you are really, really, you know, a hopeless criminal, of which I think they will cremate you, if not Tibetan way, traditional way is sky burial. You've heard of this before? Sky burial or water burial. So in my area in Amdo, Tibet, okay, what Tibetans usually do is when they die, they have a sky burial. Sky burial basically, okay, this might get a bit graphic. Okay, they will literally chop the corpses up in pieces. Okay, and then they go up to the mountaintop. And then they will feed it to the eagles. They call it gopu, eagle. Okay. And I have been in sky burial, I mean, as an observant, obviously, many times. And then, you know, Tibetans, they really revere eagles. To them, eagles are one of the sacred animals. And then I remember the first few times I was really looking forward to see eagles. And what I saw instead was another kind of predator. They are vultures. They are vultures. They're eagle family, but they're vultures. You know the difference between eagles and vultures. Eagles eat only fresh meat. Okay? And vultures eat rotten, you know, dead meat. And Tibetan, they don't like dogs. They really don't like dogs. So for them, dogs are dirty and dogs are lowly animals. So when many, many times when I went and I was in a sky burial of perhaps, you know, parents of my friend or even my friend, they made it sure that during the burial, the body was properly chopped up and then properly fed, and then the vultures will come down and eat and just peck off all the morsels and then leaving, of course, bones. So that's a field of skeletons. Okay, you walk and then you kick something and then it's a jawbone. Or you kick something, then it's a FOMO, you know, and all these things. And then during those times when I saw what the Tibetans feared the most. The surviving family members, they would go there and then they would make sure that this was done in the most dignified way. But they could not stay for, you know, for the whole process. So after about half an hour, they would leave, leaving the job to the professional. And after, as soon as the family members left, the professionals began to do a very sloppy job. You know, he would just throw things everywhere and dogs would just come. Dogs would just come and finish and would fight with the vultures. You know, the food and the morsels. You know, in the Bible, if anyone dies by the mean of having dogs eating the body, it's considered very, very bad. Jezebel, for example. Okay, so this is a group of people who are so lost and then are so, you know, live in such a dark place that they think till today that they have found a way to heaven. But what they have found is as soon as spectators left, dogs, vultures, all kinds of things that they consider unholy and dirty, they would just come and consume. It's just a form. It's just a form. There's no essence. Tibetans are obsessed with ending. They don't really care much what they do during lifetime, but the moment when you die, your thought is very important. According to the system, if you think good thought, then you stand a good chance that you will be carried off to a better karma. And the reverse is true. So there's a whole book called Book of the Dead. Okay, I don't recommend you reading it because it's very, very dark. But then it tells you how obsessed they are with ending. They want to end well. They want to end well. In the depraved mind, they know that the current life is not all there is. They know. They have been searching. They have been searching. They said, surely there is something beyond what this life can offer. Most of the Tibetans that we work with, they live very, very poorly. I learned the word dirt poor from them. They're literally in the tent when it's minus 40 Celsius outside. This is plus 40, okay? 80 degrees difference, okay? Minus 40 degrees, okay? We said you want to, for men, you want to go out and pee, you need to bring a stick, okay? You don't get a joke, never mind. So it's minus 40 degrees. Okay, and then they live on the ground. Okay, when it's so cold, they dig a hole, and then thinking that, you know, go down deeper into the hole could keep them warm, but it's just an illusion. Okay, so I learned the word dirt poor from this lovely group of people. They are friendly, they're hospitable, they'll give you the best, and yet they are so lost. For people who are so lost, they have sense to think about what's going to happen to them beyond this life, beyond this life. What about us? What about us? Okay, so flying high, first of all. Now, you know what flying high means. Okay, flying high is not lasting long. Okay? I want to tell you this, in the field that I serve, okay, now I've been there for 11, 12 years, and we have seen so many people came and went. We have seen it over the years. It got really, really precarious after 2008, that we see families just left. Okay, and then during these years, this decade, okay, I have seen my colleagues, they are from everywhere. They are from developed nations. They are from very, very established churches and mission-sending agencies. They are so equipped. They are so, in Chinese called, 有条件, okay? They are so endowed to do the job. And then they came with the family. They were ready, and then they were committed, and then they were, you know, they wanted to stay until the kingdom comes. Some of them left after 2 weeks. Some of them left after a few months, and some of them left after 1 year. And that's the majority of them. In fact, the average serving time in where I serve is about 2.5 years. So many of them, as I was telling you, they are so well endowed and equipped, and the church has spent so much money on them. And then they came, and then within short time, they were able to do a lot. You see a lot of results. You see a lot. And then the results are just spectacular. And then, just as fast as it happened, it goes down. Do you know how much it is to keep a Western? I must emphasize Western. Do you know how much it is to keep a Western missionary in the field like where I am? Guess. Every year. Okay, you guys don't know. It costs between USD 50 to 80,000 to keep one Western missionaries in the field that I'm serving today. I don't get this number. I didn't cook it up. This is done
by other researchers. Okay? Of course, you know, we are Malaysians. We know how to save money. So we get, for my whole family, not just myself, okay? Lay long, huh? You keep me in the field, you get 6 for free. And then all it does is cost you 30,000 ringgit to 40,000 ringgit a year. Okay, right now it's $1 to 4.5 ringgit, I was told. Okay, now, this is not the most detrimental statistics, okay? They are coming. Out of this, 60% won't go back after the first year. We call this attrition, okay, 60%. And out of the 60% that won't go back after first year, 2/3 of them are due to causes for what we call preventable causes, like burnout, like loneliness. You know, there are some unpreventable causes like death, for example, okay? Or marriage. Then, you know, they decide to go somewhere else. But we're talking about preventable causes. Now, you do your math. 50 to 80,000 US dollars per year. And before that, pre-field training of another 50 to 80,000 US dollar. And then after 1 year, they don't go back. Flying high is not lasting long. It's not. Okay? I'm led over these years to a conclusion that it is not so difficult, really, to fly high. Because all you need are talent and opportunities. These are two things you need if you want to fly high. Okay? So, we have a lot of young people here. Okay, you might be wondering, like, you know, what can I do for God? One day, I'm going to do this and I'm going to do that. My advice is don't aim just at flying high. Because I know with your talents that God has given you and opportunities, you are going to fly high. In fact, with your education and all that you get these days, you don't fly high, you might want to ask yourself, why not? Flying high is not lasting long. Lasting long is not living on. We have this one friend. Oh, before that, I want to tell the stories of people flying high. We have, now, these are real stories. I'm changing their names, you know, for educational and protection purpose, of course. Okay? I have these two very, very close friends. I love them dearly. They love me dearly. Let's call them Tom and Jerry. Okay? Tom and Jerry, they are from the United States of America, very endowed, very equipped. They came very talented. Both of them have Jewish blood, and then they are so talented. They are among the most talented people I know. Within 2 years, 3 years, they learn Mandarin. They learn the local dialect. Some people spend 10, 20 years, and then they still don't speak. These two individuals, within 2 years, they could speak well. This is very, very important. Okay, not only were they talented linguistically, they are so talented in business, you know, in a lot, in reaching out. They are amicable, they make friends easily. They had all the makings to be good missionaries. And then because they are so, you know, the EQ is so high, they could get money very easily. So they raise fund, and then they raise a lot at that. Then they set up shop, coffee shops, as a means to stay and as a means to train up the locals. We call it BAM, Business as Mission. Some of you might have heard of that. It's a viable model, okay? But the thing is this, they hit upon success and upon success within 1 year. They were so successful. They were making thousands of US dollars a day.
Okay, and it just went on and on. They went on, and then they opened up branches. The soon, before you know, there were branches of this brand in a lot of cities in Tibet and in China. And it came to my attention, and I wasn't the only one used by the Lord. I found out later that the Lord has used many, many more to go and warn Tom and Jerry, said, you got to slow down. Okay, slow down, brothers, because this is not America. You cannot use the American way to do this. Okay, and then your families, you know, they are being neglected. So many people have felt the Lord moving to go and give them these words. And then they did not really heed this. They were successful for the first 3 years. And then it began to come down. It wasn't a crash, but then it was coming down. Okay, at one point at a height, they were building a team. There were at least 70 people, core team. Okay? And then it went down. And then they were so busy plucking holes. Leading to the very end. This is 2016. Okay, late. No. By July of 2015, last year. They left. Okay? They chabut. And they left behind brokenness. They left behind masses for people to pick up. Literally misses, you know, masses. They were broken hearts. They were broken trust. They were broken everything. All they could do is to stand up, and then they move to another location. But the local that they left behind, it is devastating. The whole group of supporters behind, they felt that they were cheated. They felt that they were con, leading so much so that these days, I happen to know two of the major investors, they were my friends. They are still my friends. And then every time I mention the name Tom and Jerry, they get so bitter. Mind you, we're talking about Christians. They get so bitter that they call the names. They call the Tom and Jerry names. Those are crooks. Those are con men. Every time I hear this, it is like driving a dagger through my heart for many reasons, because Tom and Jerry are very close to me. I know their heart to be true. I know that they love Jesus. I know that. I prayed countless hours with them, and yet they end up in a dump. There is no legacy to talk about. They flew high, for sure. They did not last long. How about lasting long? Is lasting long good enough? I want to tell you this. Lasting long is not living on. There is this brother. He is from Scandinavian country. He by himself is already a legend when I arrive in the field. Let's call him Mickey. Okay, brother Mickey, he is already a legend, not just because he has big ears, okay? When I arrived, now he is a legend because, again, you're looking at an extremely talented vessel of God. This guy could speak one of the best Tibetan that I know by any foreigners, even better than me. You know, after a while, I think I'm okay. Right? Even today, I dare not say that I can be as good as him. When I arrived in 2005, he was already in the field for about 15 years. He was lasting long. He was lasting long. Okay? And somehow, he decided that it was good for him to go alone. So he became a Lone Ranger. Like I was telling you, he is an extremely talented individual, not just linguistically.
Okay, he was good with a lot of things. He has this physical finesse that even I, at my heyday, I could not keep up with him. He was 10 years my senior. I could not keep up with him going up the mountain. He has to wait for me. You know, and I was eating humble pie every time I was with this brother, Mickey. You know, I was very much humbled by him every single time. You know, I mean, the many, 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 many ways I looked up to him as someone that I want to be when I grew up, right? And then in 2010, 6 years ago, you might have heard or you might have remembered there was an earthquake in a place called Yushu. Okay, it's a Tibetan area. And the Lord sent us up there. I did not know why, but I know more now. Okay, to cut a long story short, we are still there 6 years on. We are still there, and then we are moving from strength to strength. I'm going to share more about this on Tuesday or maybe on tomorrow in SMCC. So if you guys have time and would like to hear more, you can attend tomorrow or Tuesday. But anyway, so because of the earthquake and then because of our involvement in the work, the first and foremost work was, of course, disaster relief. So we would distribute food, water, blankets, you know, whatnot, and medicine as well. And we started doing that, and then it became very, very apparent very soon that in a place like Tibet, it's not like, you know, it's not like place in PJ, right? It's people live one mountain, you might have one settlement, and then the next mountain, you have a few household tents, and that's about it. And between this and that, sometimes you have to travel for hours or sometimes even days. And that's how Tibetans live for thousands of years. And then it became apparent to us after a while, in order to bring timely medical care to Tibetans, we need Medicare on wheels. So I started thinking about maybe we should have a mobile clinic. And then I pitched this idea to some donors, and then one of them liked it. So they were from Australia. And they wanted to help us raise funds. And then, being Mat Saleh, they want to help raise funds in a way that is dangerous, right? So they said, we want to climb a 6,000-meter high mountain, okay? Help us put together this expedition so that, you know, we will sell this to our donors. That, like, you know, help us, sponsor us so that we, our team, will go up to a 6,000-meter mountain so they can raise funds for this mobile clinic. Now, you know, do you know how high 6,000 meter is? The highest mountain in Southeast Asia is what? Mount Kinabalu, right? I think it's 4,200 meters. Okay. Sam Kyung and Pastor Charlie and all, there are a few people, many like in 2012, you have been up to our girls' school in Golok. That was 4,200 meters, and we were playing basketballs up there. Now, anyway, the Australian teams wanted to climb a mountain. So we found a mountain, highest mountain in our area, 6,200 meters, the highest mountain in the Kunlun mountain range. Okay, it's snow-capped. It's snow-capped mountain, you know, all year round. And we decided to climb in November. And first of all, that was a big mistake, right? We were the last team in a year to go up. Second of all, in order to save money, we decided to dispense with the porters, right? Dispense with the mountain guard. I hired Brother Mickey, because he is from Scandinavian countries, he's very experienced mountaineers. I said, let's do this. I will pay you instead. You know, because he was a lone ranger, he did not have any support. So we figured we would support, you know, a fellow missionary worker this way. So he was very happy. He took upon this job, and then we went.
we went. We did not have proper equipment. We did not have proper, you know, claw. We didn't have anything. We just had very stupid, zealous heart, thinking that how difficult could this be, right? To climb a 6,000-meter mountain. It could, you know, it's just the same as climbing 4,000 meters. You know, that was all the fatal mistakes that we have made. We went up and up. The idea first was to camp at the base camp was at 5,000 meters. We would spend a night there. And then the next day, the plan was to go up and camp at the C1 at 5,600 meters. And thereafter, to attempt to submit the very next day at 3 a.m., okay, to go up to 6,200 meters. Now, those are the man's plan. The real day itself, we arrived in 5,000 meters. We camped the next day. It took us a long time. When we moved, by the time we arrived at the C1, and it wasn't even 5,600 meters, we had to stop at 5,300 meters and pitch tent. And it was dark. And then it was cold. It was minus 20 out there. You know, the wind was blowing. We were, you know, it was just difficult. Okay? And there was a guy. He was ahead of us. He went ahead, and then he stopped at 5,600 meters. And he came outside at the night. We didn't. We camped at 5,300 meters, and then the next day we went up. By the time we got to 5,600 meters, we saw that guy lying flat on the floor. Okay, it turns out that he has survived the whole night with minus 20, 25, with only one sleeping bag. Okay, and we did not know him. He wasn't part of our team. So I did not have what we call gator, because you need that to step into deep snow. And I lost one of it. So I saw that he has gators. So I asked one of my friends, I said, can you go and ask him if you could borrow a gator? And then my friend went asking for gator. And then this guy just ignored my friend. And I thought he was just being cocky. He was this arrogant guy. He has summited, and then he was down here, you know, sunning himself. So I said, okay, forget about it. You know, if he doesn't want it, I'm just going to go without gator. So we went. Only two people, I mean, at the end, I was the only one who submitted, because the rest all turned back. And then we did some stupid thing. Okay, we started attempting submitting at 2 p.m. in the afternoon. That was, the rule was at 1 p.m., any teams that were making an attempt to submit must turn back, no matter where you are, because blizzards would come. We were making a submit attempt at 2 p.m. This is stupid, okay? And we went up. We did not have anything. Like I said, I didn't even have enough water or food. I went up, and then I submitted. I came down. I almost lost the other guy who was trailing behind me. Okay, by the time I got down to 5,600 meters, 9 p.m., the Lord was merciful. He just kept. No wind, bright moon, all this. And that guy was lost in the dark. We didn't even have flash. You know how stupid we were. Okay, so we were relying on moonlight. I was calling this Chinese brother out. I said, you know, Lowly, Lowly. And no sound. And I called a few times. Eventually, I heard a very feeble sound. I was so excited. Eventually, he just crawled toward me. And then like I said, he was a new believer. I baptized him in Yishu. He believed Jesus in Yishu. So he was precious to me. And I was asking the Lord, I said, Lord, please, he is such a young believer. Please don't let me, you know, go down and get a rescue team to retrieve his body. I said, please don't do that. Please don't do that. And the Lord was merciful. He came, and then we hugged like nobody's business. And we came down. And then we came across this guy. Remember, I was telling him he was still lying there? And he was still lying there at 9 p.m. And then by then we knew that he was not an arrogant guy. He was in serious trouble. This is called hypoxia. This is called altitude sickness. He was not doing well. We tried. We said we need to carry him down. And he was a big man. He was even taller than me. We tried very hard. We could not. We were not trained to do this.
We were not trained. So eventually we made the toughest decision I have made so far in my whole life. We left him behind. Because we have to go through a very, very sharp ridge. You know, we have to put on claws. I mean, if there is a one misstep, we will all fall down to our death, certain death. Eventually, I told Lao Li, I said, we have. Because the Bible says, you know, there's no greater love than when one lays down his life for the other. I said, but this is not biblical. Okay? Because if we carry this guy, all of us will die. He will not preserve his life either. So we left him behind. We went down to our base. And then we called the rescue team. The next day they came up just to take his body down. And then, of course, the policeman came to investigate and all these things. They asked us, why do you think he died? And we said, I think he died of altitude sickness. You know, he underestimated the mountain. The biggest blow came the next day when we found out who he was. He was one of the most famous mountaineers in China. His name is Yang Ge. He has led teams to Everest. He has led rescue teams to rescue countless people in mountains that are 7,000, 8,000 meters. And he died at 5,600 meters. We were so guilty. We said, why him? Why not us? Why? An expert. And we, these two idiots, we survived, you know, without water, without anything. And this guy, he died. Remember Brother Mickey? He came down and then he has his car. And then he brought a dog. He brought a dog. And then when it was time to go, to leave, this is a disaster, we wanted to leave. And then there was enough space for either a person sitting or a dog. And he filled up his car with the Australian team. And then me and Lao Li, we have two. I told Brother Mickey, I said, please let us in the car. Please don't leave us behind. We can sit on each other's lap. Okay, dogs are not that important. You can leave them behind. I don't know whether this is a Caucasian thing or not. He chose his dog over us. He left two brothers behind to die. I have never been that angry in my whole life. I was shouting profanity at him. I said, may the Lord judge you. You SOB, right? And then I said, for you to choose a dog over your brother, may the Lord judge you. And then he drove away. You know, I just want to tell you this, like, you know, next time you get a chance to go up to Yusu to look at all the operation that the Lord has used us to set up. Remember, we really exchanged it with our lives. We were left there, me and the brother who just accepted the Lord, and then we just prayed, Lord, we have families. And the Lord sent someone, a policeman who forgot something. He came back to retrieve it, okay? So we're like, oh, you know. You don't know this, but I think you are the Lord's answer. He came and then he offered us seat. Of all the people, right? It was the heathen, the pagan that the Lord sent, not the brothers. Brother Mickey, like I said, I still have a lot of respect for him. He has served for more than 15 years. But this incident took a toll on him. He blamed himself for not being able to save that person. And I think, over the years, I kept thinking, why would he make these kind of decisions? I think he was very much affected. I moved from being extremely bitter and angry at him to a lot of pity for him. He has never gone back. He left the field. He was kicked out eventually. And he never came back. So after, I think altogether, maybe 17 years of serving in Tibet, with fluent Tibetan, with slew of talents. These days, if you go to where he served, you ask any Tibetans, do you know Mickey? They will say, that guy, he's a bad man. You know, he conned me, he cheated me, this and that. And it's very difficult to hear this. It's very difficult to hear this. You know, when it's about your comrade, when it's about your comrade in arms, when it's about brothers and sisters that you know God has sent to minister, to bring the light to the dark world of Tibet. It's very difficult to hear this. And yet, this is reality. His legacy among Tibetans is, I wouldn't even trust him. He has done us wrong. People like us, we are not in corporate world. We are not in business. When we talk about legacy, what do we talk about? What kind of legacy do we have for people like us? I used to tell this to people. I said, I have a pair of shoes that, you know, when I move on, I'm going to leave behind for my children. And then I said it, you know, I mean, it was just metaphor, okay? Metaphor. Some brother from Singapore, you know how literal they are. They took it seriously. He looked at my shoes, and then the next thing you know, he sent me a pair of shoes. Air flown from Singapore. He says, Singapore Army uses this. Okay, I look at his good pair of shoes. He says, actually, it's mine-proof. You can stand on landmine, and it blows up. Your legs are intact. I said, maybe I won't try it, okay? So the pair of shoes are still there. I said, people like us, what do we leave behind? In Proverbs 22:1, it says a good name is more desirable than great riches. To be esteemed is better than silver or gold. A good name. This is all that we could leave behind. Good name. And in Proverbs 13:22, a good person leaves an inheritance for his children's children, but a sinner's wealth is stored up for the righteous. Now, you can interpret this as materials. I have since come to interpret this as legacy. A good person, a person who follows the Lord, he or she will leave behind an inheritance, a spiritual inheritance for his children's children. In Hebrew, when it says children, repeat this word, children's children, doesn't just mean all the way to your grandchildren, that's it. It means generations after generations. It means after generations. You know, Chinese has a term when it comes to wealth. It says a curse of three generations. You know that, right? 富不过三代. Okay? They said you can be rich, but then most often, by the time it comes to your grandchildren, he will squander it off. They will all squander. 富不过三代. Okay? But you look at people who have gone ahead of us. Hudson Taylor, for example. Morrison. Hudson Taylor, the fifth, is still serving China today. This is fifth generation. They are still serving the very country that the great-great-great-grandfather loved and gave his life for after five generations. The name Taylor is a royalty among us. It might not be a good thing because everywhere a tailor goes in China, it's a lightning rod. The policemen, the religious affairs bureau, they will definitely follow them. Okay? So, last year, when I was in Oxford, I have to leave my house in the hand of my very capable wife, and I gave her a few guidelines. I said, I was told that
the tailors are going to come to our area. I said, I have high respect for them, but please don't go near them because they are lightning rod. Okay? We can talk to them outside, but don't do that because they will be followed by authority and the authority wants to see where they go and then who their associates are. I said, do not be associated with them. I came back from Oxford, happily unpacking, and then my wife was telling me, oh, you know, there was this team. And then they came, you know, to eat in the house. I mean, we have opened our house to receive so many people over the years. And then he says, there was this guy, you know, I mean, he just speaks Mandarin, you know. I mean, he's Mat Saleh, but he speaks Mandarin. And then he's like, you know, da-da-da-da. I said, wait, is he this tall? I said, and then she said, yeah. Does he look like that? I said, yeah. Does he speak Mandarin like this way? I said, yeah. I said, that is the tailor. I asked you to have nothing to do with him, and then you took them inside my house. I said, I'm doomed, right? You can always trust the Americans to run the world. But like I said, for the record, I have high respect for the tailors. When we are talking about legacy, fifth generations, and then they do not show sign of declining. They are going on and on. Okay? They are going to serve China until the kingdom comes. Okay? You talk about legacy. You talk about good name. Okay? So, lasting long is not living on. So what is living on? Okay, lasting long, just like what I was sharing with you just now, flying high, all you need are talents and opportunities. You can fly high. How about lasting long? What do you need? All you need to last long are support and endurance. That's all you need. You don't need talents even. Okay? What Pastor Chu was sharing just now, I'm doing a PhD. Okay, and I have an opportunity in my research to come across, to interview and to make case studies out of a lot of missionary leaders who have done wrong. Some of them have been serving in the field for 20 years. Okay, I approached 30 of them. Only 10 of them are willing to participate. The rest are not willing for very obvious reasons. Okay, and I'll tell you this. I look at them, it seems to me that when they erred, during the time when they made bad decisions leading to what I call malfeasance, okay, it's a legal term of wrongdoing, be it adultery, being embezzlement, being ministry theft, being you name it, they seem to occupy a certain maturity phase. That's my study, maturity phase. So I'm convinced with my years of serving and observation and coupled with my research that in order to live on, brothers and sisters, you need maturity. You need to be mature. Okay? Now, what is maturity? That's my 83,000 word on, okay? So I'm not going to preach to you on what maturity is. If you're interested, I will send Pastor Chu a copy, and then, you know, you can get it from him within this year. Okay, so it's maturity. When we talk about living on, almost always, you don't talk about money. You do not talk about, because like I said, three generations is all over. You don't talk about materials. You don't talk about setting a stature of yourself up. We all know what happened to Nebuchadnezzar. Okay? You don't talk about that. When we talk about living on, we almost always talk about living behind a spiritual legacy. It's your name. It's your attempt for great things for God. Your examples. And by that, I don't just mean your success. It's your failures. It's the lessons that you learn from your failures. It's your all in all. It's your package that you leave behind for future generation to glean from. They will take, come good and bad, they will take what you leave behind for them. I have a very close brother, my family member even. He's my uncle. Okay? Let's call him Uncle Cha Siu. Okay? Uncle Cha Siu is very close to me. He has been a strong supporter for us over these years. Okay, in our work. And I grew up in awe of him, to be honest with you. There were only two people that I grew up in awe in my life. One is my father, one is him. So you can and you know, he was at when I first got my job, when I went to college, he was able to dispense wisdom to me. He was like my mentor in so many ways. He came and visited me 2 years ago in Tibet. We had a great time. You know, as usual, he just blessed us so much. Then last year, the bad news arrived. My auntie informed me by July last year that my uncle Cha Siu has fallen into adultery. The worst thing is this. His church is not willing to confront him because he is such a major donor. I told my auntie, what kind of church is this? If your pastor is not doing what he is called to do, you should leave this church. You should never call this church. You call this social club. Okay? Call this Tanglin Club or something. Okay? But don't ever call it church. Okay? Now, I want you to know that you're in a good church. Because I know for a fact that when any of you are going astray, your head shepherd, he, she, they take it seriously. They take it seriously. Okay, it is painful when you are disciplined. But trust me, you don't want to be in a church when the head shepherds have fallen asleep. I don't care how big it is. This is not a number game. This is a family. Who among you, when you see your own children have gone astray and you choose to stay quiet, you are not a good parent. Okay? And this is church. This church does not do that. Okay? Your pastoral teams may say things that you think are hurtful to you. And do take it personally, because it is personal. They meant well for you. Okay? So you are in a good church. Please stay in this church and bring your friends. Okay? But my uncle's church, not so. So I was very troubled. I said, for Chinese culture, I am in no place to say anything to him. Okay? I said, this is supposed to be the pastor's job. So I said, Lord, someone has to speak the truth to him. And it's supposed to be a pastor or the elder's job, and no one is stepping forward. So it happened, it transpired. To the opportunity, it became clear that I was the one to say something to my uncle. Imagine this. I grew up in awe of this brother. The time came, I wrote a letter. I asked him a question. I said, how do you want your children and your children's children to remember you? You want them to remember you as someone who has done well and at the end fall flat to his face and never came back? Or you want them to remember you as someone who has done well and fall but then decides to come back to the fold of God and make good, and the end was better than the beginning? I said, it's your choice. It's your choice. Sadly, to this day, he has chosen to go on his path. But brothers and sisters, we all have choice. This is one thing, right? Free will. This is one thing that the Lord has gone to the cross to preserve for us. Don't ever take your free will lightly. The Lord dies at the cross to preserve your free will. We all have a choice ahead of us. Today, this year, your lifetime, you can choose to leave behind a godly legacy and thereby live on and live beyond. Or you can choose to fly high, you can choose to last long, and then stop at that. Then when you pass on, people will remember you as someone who, yeah, he flew high, and yeah, yeah, she lasted long, and there was that. You have a choice, brothers and sisters. You can be in business, you can be a student, you can be a teacher, you can be a businessman, you can be in full-time ministry, whatever realm you are. You, as child of God, you make a choice today. What legacy you want to leave behind for your children and your children's children? The Bible says a good person leaves behind good inheritance for children's children. Okay, let's look at Isaiah 40, verse 30 to 31. Every youth, you are very familiar with this, grow tired and weary, and young men stumble and fall. But those who hope in the Lord will renew their strength. They will soar on wings like eagles. They will run and not grow weary. They walk and not be faint. From this, you see this. Flying high, every youth, every young man, by the virtue of your youth and young age, you can fly high. That is no big deal. After a while, some people will go on, but then it says, eventually you will grow tired, no matter how long you can last. You grow tired. You grow weary. You even stumble and fall. You cannot last long. But those who hope in the Lord will do what? Will renew the strength. The Hebrew word, renew the strength. The renew is not one time. It's continuous. Those who hope in the Lord, they will continue to renew and renew and renew the strength. They will continue to soar on wings. They will continue to run and run, and they will continue not to grow weary, and they will continue to walk, and they will continue not to be faint. This is the only... I'm not there yet. Okay? I'm just entering my lasting long stage. Okay? I'm thinking, how can I live on? How? What kind of legacy? And I found this secret I want to share with you. Those who hope in the Lord. Those who hope in the Lord. Meaning what? Meaning when you pray to God, it's not a list. You all know this. You know, SIB is a praying church. You know how to pray. It's not just request, right? You wait to hear from the Lord what he wants you to do. Beyond that, you wait. Those who wait on the Lord will soar like eagles. Not those who go for any operation, okay, or go for any training. It's those who wait on the Lord will soar like eagles. So how do you last long? You only need support and endurance. How do you live on? You need spiritual maturity to wait on the Lord, even when it costs you, even when it's painful to you. This, I have so much to share, but I think the time has come to an end. So, like I said, Tuesday I'll share more on in details. Now, we are going to end this service the way Chinese church does. Okay, they always end with a buffet. No, they always end with the Lord's Prayer. They always end with the Lord's Prayer. So we are going to sing the Lord's Prayer in Chinese to you, and we will end this service. Okay, Minnie, Miney, come up.
Hello?
This is, like I said, this is the Lord's Prayer in Chinese. If any one of you know, please do sing along, okay?
Let's give God a good clap offering. Why don't you all stay on the stage? Can we pray for you? Let's pray for them. Shall we do that? Come, let's all stand and let's pray. You know, while they are arranging themselves, you know, I just want to say that, you know, at the end of the day, what Philip shared is really true. Ultimately, what kind of legacy we left behind? You know, a man that probably in the world today, he will be so successful. And yet, why would he spend his days going into the darkest part, one of the darkest parts of the world, and giving his life to serve Jesus? Isn't it amazing? And yet, through all the problems and difficulties, well, it's worth it. It's worth it. Amen? Amen. It's a good lesson for all of us. Live well for God, always say, huh? Maybe now additional term, fly high, last long, live on, live beyond. Fly high, last long, and live beyond. In other words, beyond your life, huh? Beyond this physical life. Live beyond the physical life with eternity in mind. Amen. Let's stretch our hands to us, MSB. Can I ask Pastor Lee Chu to come up as well? Let's stretch our hands towards them. I want our Apostle Lee Chu to pray first.
Hallelujah, Lord. Oh, Rakasia Kasanda Rakadadada. Hallelujah, Lord. Surely you have spoken to us even today. Surely you are saying to us, do not even just be satisfied with flying high or lasting long. But surely you're saying to us, even as a church, in SIB, what legacy, what will SIB be known for many, many years later? Even 50 years from now, what will we be known for? Father, we're just so blessed today to hear from our brother and even the children and even our sister, Lord. Surely, O Lord God, yes, let it be into their hearts a desire, O Lord God, to be leaving behind a legacy that will cause the name of Jesus to constantly be remembered, that even though, Lord God, that the thought of who they are will cause others to praise the Lord, to give glory to God, for surely this is the legacy you have given to them. And so, Lord, even today as we stand here to bless your holy name together with Becky and the children and Philip, oh Lord God, Father, we ask you to sustain them, not just by human support, not just by any other means, even by human endurance, but Father, may they be constantly supported by the strength of the Holy Spirit, by the wings of love of our Lord Jesus Christ and our Father God, that indeed, oh Lord God, they will be able to soar with wings as eagles, not because they have made a determination to do that, but because the Lord carries them upon His wings, oh Lord God. Father, we pray for each of the children that they will inherit this godly legacy, that each of them will continue to be like the tailors many generations later. They carry this legacy. Oh, we bless them. We bless this family. We pray that you will surround them with a holy hedge, with the fire, oh Lord God, of heaven around them, with guardian angels guarding every step of the way, and even the blood of Jesus Christ to be their portion, surrounding them, putting a holy hedge that even as the blood of Jesus Christ encircles them, nothing can come against them, because they belong to the legacy that Jesus wants them to own and to pass it on. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen. Let's pray. Father, we thank you for this life lived for you. What a wonderful model and example to all of us, that truly, Lord, we don't give you leftovers. We give you the very best, because you deserve the very best. So, Father, we pray that we will live well for you, so that generations after generations will not remember what we do for them, give for them, what we leave behind. It's not the shoes, it's the footprints. It's not the shoes, Lord. It's the footprints. And the footprints is the footprints of Jesus Christ and what He has done for us. So, Father, we want to live well for you. So, Father, we commit this whole Poe family to you. You bless them. You bless them. Protect them. Give them a good rest, even if they're back here for Chinese New Year. Give them a good break, Lord. And affirm them again and again. They are the apple of your eye. Thank you, for you love them. You care for them. And the children will grow up well, loving you as well, that legacy, generation after generation, like the tailors, the poles will also have a godly legacy, Lord. You speak it into their life, and it's the best thing you can ever do for them. The best reward you can give for Philip's sacrifice and Becky's sacrifice is their children will also love you back even more, even more, even more. Thank you, Father. Thank you, Jesus, for everything. All good things that come from you, we give you back all the glory. In Jesus' precious name, we pray, and our God's people say, Amen. Come on, let's give God a good clap offering.